What is that? SpaceX overhauls the design for the Starship heat shield yet again. But why? Booster 15 rolls to Massey's to begin testing. What's the situation? SpaceX begins preparation for chopstick installation on the new pad, and Rocket Lab shows off their launch pad while Blue Origin has some trouble using theirs. My name is Felix, welcome to What About It. Let's dive right in. Starship updates. Flight 7 is so close. As of now, the only specific date we have for launch is January 11th, and it seems SpaceX is more than on track to make it happen. Booster 14 completed its testing campaign a couple of weeks ago, and in a true show of speed, Ship 33 has completed its own as well. So with both of them now back at the build site receiving upgrades, it's only a matter of time as all pieces are in place, including the launch license. This means that for two launches in a row, SpaceX is on its own schedule. No more FAA delays. This is why we were so excited to see SpaceX adding the ship lifting pins back to the chopsticks. These help stabilize the ship when it's being placed onto the booster, so having them reinstalled means we should hopefully see a ship lift soon. The next full stack is coming soon. Flight 7 is truly going to be bananas, if you know what I mean. Just like the previous two flights, this one will come with quite a bit of extra risk. As of now, SpaceX only has one launch pad for Starship, which needs to survive both the launch and the catch of the Super Heavy booster. However, even if it's successful, it doesn't exactly do the best job at that, as constant repairs are needed. Now that Booster 14 has completed its static fire testing campaign, we know the launch mount is operational. However, we've still seen a ton of work to prepare it for Flight 7. Most of it likely involved upgrades. SpaceX knows that this launch mount design is impractical, so they've decided to overhaul it completely with Pad B, which also acts as a backup if, for example, a booster misses a catch. This pad is quickly approaching completion, especially over the past few days when we've seen some truly extraordinary work. Almost all of this work has been done in preparation for chopstick installation. Yep, SpaceX will finally install the chopsticks on this tower. We know this because to install the chopsticks, they must be fully assembled on the ground before being lifted onto the tower. However, due to the shape of the chopsticks, doing this on the ground can be quite complicated. A separate support structure is required to build the chopsticks on the ground safely before installing them on the tower. And now SpaceX has begun constructing that support structure. Yes! These can be clearly identified by their bright red shading, which is quite different from any other structure seen at Starbase. Along with that, we've also seen even more work on the tower itself, likely some finishing touches before the chopsticks and ship quick disconnect are installed. That's not the only news on this side of the launch site. SpaceX has also begun removing its old gate, which used to be a vehicle entrance and displayed the SpaceX Gateway to Mars sign. It is a bit sad to see all of the signs disappear at the launch site, as we've already lost the Gateway to Mars sign, which was torn down a few months ago. Although this is for a good reason, and we've known it was going to happen for quite a while, as SpaceX's expansion plans have an air separation unit right where the sign was. I wouldn't be surprised at all if the Gateway to Mars sign returns to a different spot at some point. The air separation plan will allow SpaceX to finally begin producing some of the much-needed gases, such as nitrogen and oxygen, directly from the atmosphere on site, instead of using trucks to ship it on the increasingly deteriorating two-lane road to the launch pad. You have to keep in mind that everything that is at Starbase now was moved over Highway 4, which was never built for this. Once all those gases are produced, they are going to need a spot to be stored, which is why we see so much work on the tank farm, including the installation of two gigantic new tanks. And now SpaceX has begun connecting those tanks as well as the tank farm itself to Pad B. We've seen shipment after shipment of pipes coming from the Sanchez site to the launch site to be installed underground to connect this tank farm to the new launch pad. Speaking of Sanchez, the equipment there has received massive amounts of work over the past few days. But before I tell you about that, we've looked into our channel metrics, and there are over 2 million returning monthly viewers who have not subscribed yet. Please help us improve the channel even further by double checking that you've hit that subscribe button so you don't miss our updates. While you're at it, give us a like and become a Y supporter. Why? Because you'll gain access to a massive amount of extra content. With it, you get access to daily new Starbase photo galleries, including all those we've posted so far, satellite, aerial, and ground photos, more than 400 posts in the past 2 years alone, with up to 7 picture galleries per week, insights, chats with me, you name it. Thank you so much, you rock. Now back to the launch mount. We've seen massive amounts of work on almost every part of the new pad over here, including final prep work for the chopsticks before they're rolled to the launch site. Most of the work has focused on the launch mount, which has received its internal pipework and shielding. It has quite a bit of shielding, including a water-cooled launch deck, which will act in a very similar way to the water-cooled steel plate used for the flame deflector at pad A. However, this will be on the top of the launch mount to protect it and not below as on the old pad. We've also seen the first pieces of shielding being installed on the internal ring of the mount, which fills in the gaps between the Raptor quick disconnects and hold down clamps. Every little seam needs to be closed. If the booster flames can find a way inside, they'll destroy the launch mount from the inside. Looking over a bit, the flame diverter has also continued growing as workers install more of the support beams to make up the underlying structure of it to ensure it can withstand the immense force of the world's largest rocket booster launching and landing at it. Overall, SpaceX has kicked into high gear with the construction of these pieces as they work to bring this launch pad online. What do you think? Which flight will be the first to take place at the new launch pad? Number 8? Number 9? Give me your best guess in the comments below the video. While all that work was being done at Sanchez, there was one component that left Sanchez for the production facility. It's a piece of hardware specialized in pressing against the engine mounts when they still don't have engines, to simulate a complete set of 33 Raptor engines pushing against the booster. Same as in flight. Yep, so it is time to test yet again, in this case, booster 15. On the night of the 20th, after the thrust simulator was rolled into the mega bay, booster 15 was lifted off its workstand and placed onto it. It waited until the night when a road closure was implemented. The booster then rolled out of the mega bay and up Highway 4 to Massey's, where it will undergo its first verification tests. This should include a couple of cryogenic proof tests, in which the booster is partly filled with cryogenic liquid nitrogen, while the thrust simulator mimics the force of the 33 Raptor engines to ensure it can handle the pressure. This test will be extremely important as booster 15 is the first we're aware of with a modified header tank that appears to have multiple COPVs, or composite overwrapped pressure vessels, wrapped around it. Small black pill-shaped tanks that are used to store gases needed to restart the engines in flight. We were able to get a pretty good look at it as it was rolled from the Star Factory over to the Mega Bay for stacking a few months ago. It is possible Booster 14 had similar modifications, as these may be needed to properly return to the pad after carrying the heavier Block 2 ships. However, it is unclear. Either way, this booster is definitely more interesting than many of the previous ones. It's likely a stepping stone before SpaceX introduces the Block 2 booster, which has 35 engines. So this may be something like a Block 1.5. And speaking of Booster 14, it appears to be receiving some modifications. Shortly after Booster 14 was rolled back to the Star Factory, it began receiving scaffolding near its common dome. Now we know what that was for, as SpaceX appears to have installed some sort of reinforcement in this area. Huh? We're not quite sure why SpaceX decided to place reinforcements here, as there have been no previous signs of extra stress near this location. However, this might be related to the fact that it will be carrying a Block 2 ship. Thanks to their extended fuel capacity, Block 2 ships are quite a bit heavier. If so, we should see similar upgrades on Booster 15. We'll be sure to keep an eye out for it. So these boosters have some pretty strange components on them, but that is nothing compared to what we were able to spot the other day being installed on Ship 36. While this ship is still under construction in the Star Factory, we were able to spot something truly fascinating thanks to our photographer Sean Doherty, who was out in the middle of the night to catch a glimpse inside the Star Factory. Check this out. Yep, your eyes are not deceiving you, those are red heat tiles. These are quite different from anything we've seen before. The closest comparison is tiles that have been glued onto the ship. It might be a coating of some sort. It's clear SpaceX is trying something new with these tiles, and to try and figure out what it is, we need to learn a bit about how Starship heat tiles work in the first place. Many other spacecraft today have heat shields made of an ablative material that flakes off during re-entry, absorbing heat with each flake. However, this means the heat shield needs to be replaced after every flight. An ablative shield wears off, not reusable. Starship uses a different approach, where the tiles absorb the heat, similar to what NASA did on the iconic space shuttle. They are extremely good at keeping that heat trapped and not letting it transfer through the shield to the vehicle's body. This allows the tiles to be used time and time again, although SpaceX has been having some trouble with these tiles, with almost constant cracking and even times where they appear to have flaked off during re-entry. In other words, they are not quite as reusable as SpaceX would like them to be. Another important note about the heat tiles is that they consist of two main layers. The main structure, which is white, and a thin outer skin, which is black. So what you see on the outside of these tiles is just the very, very thin outer skin. Where it's damaged, you can see that this is a super thin coating on the outside of the tile. That's why it's likely that SpaceX is just experimenting with different materials for the outer skin of the tile while leaving the internal structure fairly similar. This new outer layer may be an attempt to combat the flaking we had seen on previous flights, or a new material blend to try and keep the tiles more protected. It does also appear that this is just for experimentation, as these tiles are over the header tank at the nose tip, which would typically be at cryogenic temperatures, providing an extra layer of protection if the tiles were to fail for some reason. These tiles are also placed on the top of the ship. During re-entry, they are not subjected to direct plasma flow. Hopefully, this new tile will improve the reliability and reusability of these tiles, as that is a key part of making the ship reusable. The shield is definitely what keeps me worrying the most right now. What do you think? Why are they red and what's changed? Let us know in the comments below and let's see if we can figure it out together. As SpaceX works to build the world's first fully reusable rocket, other companies are fast-tracking the development of a partially reusable one, and many of them are catching up quickly. One such company is Rocket Lab, which has been developing its Neutron medium lift rocket for the past few years in an attempt to compete with the Falcon 9. It is quickly approaching its first launch. But to launch, you need a launch pad, and it looks like Rocket Lab now has its own. In just a few weeks, they were able to go from this to this. They've now placed the main structure for the launch mount on top of the support beams they had built. However, this pad still needs quite a bit of work and it appears fairly empty. Rocket Lab is a quick mover and this will likely be filled in relatively quickly in time for Neutron's first launch. As Neutron appears to be getting closer to launch, it seems Blue Origin's New Glenn kept running into more trouble as it patiently waited for regulatory approval for its static fire. Fortunately, while waiting for the flames, we got some ice. Blue Origin decided to use this time to perform a full wet dress rehearsal of New Glenn 1, with the first and second stages fully filled and an artificial timer counting down to check the systems. This is a crucial step towards flight. With it now out of the way, all that's left is the static fire and New Glenn will be set to fly. This is why we were so excited on the night of the 21st when it was filled up again and our sources told us they were going for the static fire. Yes! Except no static fire happened as the vehicle eventually detanked, leaving us waiting. It appears this was an abort. We have no information yet on what caused it, but it may have been a leak. After all, New Glenn has a Hydrolox upper stage and liquid hydrogen is known for being tricky to contain. For example, just look at the trouble SLS had before its first launch. Hydrogen is the smallest known atom, a proton with a positive charge and one electron with a negative charge. That's it, very little mass, and so it can slip through anything, even solid steel, very hard to handle. Given that it's taking so long for the static fire to happen, it now appears likely that New Glenn will end up being pushed back to early next year. Innovation truly is the name of this new space age, with the best technology set to dominate the market. While it may seem that companies are doing all the innovation lately, NASA has been doing some of its own. It may not seem like it, especially in terms of rocketry, but NASA is by far the best when it comes to exploring the solar system and strange new worlds. One of the best examples in recent memory was a small demonstration mission sent to Mars in 2020 along with the Perseverance rover. The little helicopter that could, Ingenuity. This tiny unmanned flying machine was the first ever to perform a powered flight on another planet, showing that it was in fact possible. That's why it was called a technology demonstrator. Then it took off again and again and again until it reached 72 total flights. Originally planned were 5 test flights over 30 Mars days, or SOLDs as scientists call them. Unfortunately, this mission ended earlier this year in January after it chipped its rotor blade. Now NASA has finally announced the reason why, and it's not what you'd think. The main cause of the accident was a failure of Ingenuity's navigation system, which primarily relied on cameras tracking distinct points of interest on terrain to allow it to keep track of where it was and where it was going. Unfortunately, on the last flight, the terrain was mostly uniform, consisting of what are essentially sand dunes. This made it extremely difficult for the navigation software to work out any information through its vision-only system. Eventually, when the craft came down, it was moving laterally at around 2 meters a second and landed on what it believed to be a flat surface. However, it was actually the slope of a dune, and whenever it landed on the dune, the blade shattered. But how did that happen? The simplest solution would be to say that the blades impacted the sloped surface, causing them to break off. However, there were no signs of that. And what the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, short JPL, and NASA engineers found out was surprising to say the least. Whenever Ingenuity landed, it twisted over to allow all 4 feet to settle on the ground. However, this rapid movement put extra stress on the blades, which were still spinning. Due to their angular momentum, they overstressed a point around 2/3 of the way down the blade, causing it to snap at that point. This is extremely interesting and will likely be considered in the design of any future vehicles going to Mars. The high RPM required to make powered flight happen in a very thin Martian atmosphere can make a scenario like this more likely. If the blades had been a bit stronger or the navigation system a bit more robust, Ingenuity might still be flying today. Other problems on the flight included an electrical outage and a few unknowns that engineers are trying to resolve. However, you can have complete confidence in their ability to do so. And on that note, around the same time as the announcement of the Ingenuity incident report, JPL shared something just as incredible. Check this out. This is a new concept developed by JPL for a new helicopter on Mars that is similar to Ingenuity. Except this one is quite a bit bigger. While Ingenuity was a tech demonstrator with no real scientific payload, this chopper would be big enough to conduct research and learn about the red planet. Featuring 6 large blades, assuming each blade is about the same size as Ingenuity's, that would put this vehicle around the 8 to 10 feet in size, which would put it around the same size as the Curiosity or Perseverance rovers, at least when it comes to length. However, given Mars's thin atmosphere, this vehicle's overall mass would still be quite low at only 5 kilograms of payload. We can also assume that this helicopter would have some redundancy with the blades, as it's clear losing a blade isn't out of the realm of possibilities. It is important to remember that this is only a concept. However, all missions begin as concepts, and with NASA already developing another flying craft, Dragonfly, to explore Saturn's moon Titan, it's likely that NASA will begin looking closer at an even greater number of vehicles capable of powered flight. NASA is truly unmatched in its exploration of the solar system's unknowns and its efforts to pave new ways of exploration. These are just a few of many incredible examples. Their work helps to show us what is truly possible. I want to see even more daring missions like Ingenuity, as the cost to get to space lowers and the willingness to take risks increases. That's it for today. Remember to smash that like button. Subscribe for more. This is what fuels the algorithm. This is how you can help us for free. Check out our epic shirts in your favorite space nerd store. A new Raptor design and our brand new Starship Block 2 design are both up. The perfect Christmas gifts. Link is in the description and in the card you should see now. Also, check out our print store at shop.whataboutit.space to buy a picture for your favorite wall. A significant amount of every purchase goes directly to our photographers. And if you want to train your space IQ even further, watch this video next to continue your journey. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you again in the next episode. The increasingly deteriorating of these Pisces. And with NASA. Ha.